I'm now excited to introduce our special guest speaker invited by the SDSN Turkey Network. Mr. Mustafa Sekin is the CEO of Unilever in Turkey. He also chaired the UN Global Compact Network of Turkey from 2016 to 2019. And he's a board member for the Business Council for Sustainable Development of Turkey. Mr. Sekin, I invite you to please turn on your camera and your mic. I'm gonna stop sharing this video.
Thank you, Lauren.
Great.
Thank you very much for this nice introduction. And it's a great privilege and honor for me to be in that session of the UN SDSN. I'm very proud because of a couple of things. As Lauren said, I was the president of the UNGC in Turkey, and it gave me a huge opportunity to understand the UN, and I had wonderful fellows, wonderful friends around, and that's one reason. And secondly, of course, it gave me a huge horizon about the SDGs, which I call myself a passionate advocate for that. And we had a wonderful session with Jeffrey Sachs, professor, and Paul Polman. I had the luxury, again, a privilege of working with Paul in Unilever. In a way, he was a pioneer who really teach us about the sustainable living, sustainability, and proud to be here today. When it comes to food, it's a giant subject. In 15 minutes, I will try to give you two messages, one with logic, the other one is a bit the magic. As you can imagine, the magic part will be related to the happiness. And but the logic part, let's talk a bit the foods and the challenges on the foods. If this session was only 60 days ago or 2 months ago, I would certainly tell you proudly what we do as Unilever on food system, agriculture, and still I can say a few words on that. But in the context of today, I would certainly try to give a horizon with COVID lenses, what other extra stress points we have, how do we see as food industry the next months. I think it could be a good opportunity to tell you in a few minutes. But before coming to that one, already in the last 10 years, we have seen a huge pressure on the safety of the food, as we know. The agricultural land, which was getting minimized, the way technology somehow, unfortunately, didn't really transform the agriculture to the level that it could. The government policies, the company policies, everything in a way put a lot of stress under food. That was known. But companies like Unilever, we were the pioneer of that one. We made a bold commitment that before 2020, which is this year, we wanted to do our top 12 ingredients 100% sustainable. I can proudly say that we are not far. We are almost 90%. We achieved that goal, which is wonderful. As one of the, for example, tea producing country in Turkey, we have 100% of our teas from sustainable farming, which is wonderful. Not only that, but there is also a lot of systematic change needed. One of them was definitely the diversity in the foods, because dietary shift towards more plant-based things, affordable, nutritious, diverse foods. They were all in the agenda, and with our brands, with our company, we played a major role to really change the game with the consumers, with the customers, hand to hand. But today, I think on top of the existing pressures of the food safety and food systems, now we have more of that. An average consumer going to the shelf, and if they cannot find sugar, flour, or simple things on the shelf, it creates a panic. We have seen that in many countries in the COVID time, and unnecessary panic shopping creates a lot of other pressures in the system, and is a vicious cycle, unfortunately. So the first days of the restrictions, by the way, today 93% of the world is under restriction and mobility is close to zero. We have to mind that one. We have seen every kind of panic shopping around the food, and it created a certain imbalance in the supply demand in many areas of the world, and including in the markets that I am operating, like Turkey, Central Asia, and Iran. That was the first, in a way, reaction. I think every crisis, like every crisis, there are phases of that one. After the reactive state, what is important is to see how the rebound will happen. And on top of that one, as a third layer, there is an expected recession that we all know in the coming months, a global recession where the intensity will be different from country to countries. Unfortunately, more sensible in the underdeveloped countries. And the fourth phase will be about reimagining. So where we are now, but I can clearly say that the react phase is over. So we have seen what we have to see, and we have seen all kinds of the panic. Our company, we rapidly, globally, we moved from the offices to living at home, and it systematically changed the consumer life as well. So what is next in the agenda? On the rebound side, definitely we have some little bit more visibility about the next weeks, months, and maybe rest of the year. There are many scenarios. As you know, next normal is the things that has been discussed. But a couple of things happened and will stay long with us, with, I can say, around the food and food safety and importance. First of all, the provenance and appreciation of the food is very important. Why I am saying that one? As I said, we always assume that food will be abundant. Whenever we go to a shop, if we pay a few pennies, you will get some food. This is not true. Millions of the people, when they have seen empty shelves in many shops, it created, in a way, a big change. And that created appreciation of the food, that it will not be with us if we are not doing the right things all the time. So I hope that will create a positive change in the coming months, days, and years to, in a way, bring a sustainable solution around the food challenges. The second thing which happened, first of all, in-home living versus out-of-living is now the predominant way of living. And whatever circumstances are, it will stay for a while with us. We predict that in-home living at the expense of out-of-living will stay in the coming months. We like it or not, the transformation will be slow. In that sense, again, it has a lot of implication what kind of food, in which system they have to be served to consumer, how the change should be established is very critical. The other maybe important, in a way, appreciation, of course, should go to what food plays in the role of in the life of the people, because we discovered again that connecting around the food in a dinner or making a bread together with the family, with the kids, can be a source of the happiness. Something that we knew before has been forgotten long time. So before I come to the emotional and happiness side of the food, if I say a few words on that one, today, the biggest challenge on top of the existing challenge of the food industry is definitely to keep a consistent and uninterrupted supply chain. And is a big challenge because now, again, distances are more than before. Many cross borders are restricted. And it looks like rather than the global solutions, local solutions in the coming months will be very important. Are every country and company ready for it? I don't think so. Because we always assume that food will be there, globalization will be at the speed that we know even more, and we unfortunately underestimated the power of the local. And now we have to go back and in a way to integrate to our supply chains the local food supply very quickly and in a very cost-efficient way. The second big challenge waiting ahead of existing problems for the food is definitely the recession. The recession, which has been even not a forecast now, is a reality in the coming months, will bring another dimension and complexity. We have been dealing with some recessions high devaluations in some countries before. We know how to cope with that. But we don't know yet how to cope with all these complexities together. And on top of that, recession will be another layer of difficulties or complexity, which has to be addressed for sure. Last but not the least, I would like to say that the companies are quite resilient. I can say from Unilever that up to now, all our factories are working day and night. And as a company who produce foods and hygiene, I think we have a big role for the communities that we are in. And our supply chain people, together with the CD, are as I said, trying to make the products on shelf day and night. It's a huge effort, very worthy. And I really believe that that will be very important in the coming days to keep a healthy, sustainable, and uninterrupted food supply chain. That's what may be the key message I want to leave with you. The second part of the my messages around a bit the magic part of the food, because every time as an executive working in the foods industry now almost 30 years, I am fascinated with the power of the food. I am fascinated what it creates in people, and I am fascinated how it connects us and how it gives us happiness. So because any attempt of sharing a food, isn't it a sign of a generosity? Isn't it a sign of a compassion? And those two things, generosity and compassion, in the last decades, something that we have been, in a way, we knew it, but we were not demonstrating every day in the daily rush of the things. So basically, as I said, baking a cake or bread again with a family became a happiness moment of these times. Who would expect that one? It's a big, big change, isn't it? But as I said, I mean, in every case, food is not just a nutrition, is not just about filling the stomach, or is not just about keeping alive. It has emotionally a lot of other messages around us. When we say, let's have a cup of tea, it's not about just drinking a liquid or tea. It means let's have a chat, let's talk. So it's an invitation to a conversation. It's very emotional. After a cold day coming to home and having a cup of bowl of soup is something very warm. And also again, around the table, start the conversation. So we know that food is the source of the happiness. And what maybe we don't remember, but I would like to remind everyone, a crisis which has been solved by a generous compassion, and food was there. If we go back to the birth moment of every individual, it's a big crisis. Coming to a life is a big crisis. From a comfortable, dark, and food generous place, oxygen, light, and crisis, we start to cry. This is the first moment of the life. And then, obviously, breastfeeding of a mom with compassion brings us to life, is a big connection. And food, our old and first experience, and sustaining in life start with the food. So I believe it's a very, very emotional subject, source of happiness. And who can say this is the what we need the most? In a time where instead of GMPs, we are talking about GDH or GDW, gross domestic well-being or gross domestic happiness, how can we ignore importance of foods there? So again, it's not just a business, it's not a systematic solution, not only a survival, it's a mental element. And also, we have to definitely treat and be kind with the food and food solutions. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you so much, Mustafa. And I really appreciate your message, especially in these trying times with COVID-19, the challenges that we face in, you know, going to maybe an empty market or isolating at home. But we're so grateful for the work that Unilever is doing to keep us fed and clean while we're doing that. And I love your idea of sitting around the family table, sharing a meal, enjoying the culture of food, enjoying each other's company, which is a really hopeful and perhaps the silver lining in the trying times that we're going through.
Thank you, Lauren. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mustafa.